More gold up for grabs here at the Tokyo Metropolitan Gymnasium, the Tokyo 2020 Paralympic Games. The various medal events here coming towards a conclusion here at this wonderful arena that's played host to plenty of top quality competition over the past week. Lots more to come, including in this session here. Well, we've had some excellent matches already, but what we've got to look forward to in this session, a couple more gold medal matches in the standing classes. First of all, the women's singles class 9 gold medal match. Zhong Guiyan of China taking on Lei Linar of Australia. And you can see later on the class 10 gold medal match in the women's singles, Yang Qian against Bruna Costa Alexandra of Brazil. Australia against Brazil in that one. It'll be China against Australia in this one. Just had a terrific match which has just finished actually adjacent to this, so we're going to have the players in very soon for this. So just on table 6 adjacent here to table 2. Interesting always when the events come down towards the end, when you have all those tables to start with in an arena and then at the end there are just one or two remaining, you know you're getting towards the most important matches.
The arena looks a little bit empty, but of course the final matches deserve all the attention being on them. Hence only the two tables, one for wheelchair finals and the one will be on table number 2 for standing finals. On your left, the podium, which is where we'll see all these players later on, having secured themselves at least a silver medal, of course, but when gold is up for grabs, you don't want to lose that.
What's the mentality like? I mean, with a gold medal match you're preparing for, you see a lot of them. Is it different mentally compared to all the other matches that you play in an event?
Well, I've only experienced that myself once at the Paralympic Games, but I was a newcomer, so of course, yeah, I was happy to have already won silver anyway, and I assume all these players, in a way, have less pressure on them as well. But yeah, as I said, when you have a chance for gold, you want to go for it, and this is a once in a 4 or 5 year time opportunity tournament, so yeah. You want to give it your all, but there's no risk of coming home as a failure. Although we have here a player who already has 5 Paralympic golds, 2 of them in singles from the last 2 games. So I'm sure she wouldn't initially be happy with only the silver, in quotes, of course.
No, I totally understand that completely. And as you can see, the podium they're set up for later, these remaining few events. And of course we've got the team events to come as well over the next few days, coming off hot off the back of this as well, so lots more to come here. It's been a busy venue, this one, actually, not just at the Paralympic Games, of course the Olympic Games beforehand, been a busy time really for the sport if you think about all the elite athletes that have been involved here at the gymnasium over the last weeks.
Yeah, table tennis is one of the strongest represented para sports at these Paralympics, second only to athletics, I believe. But especially for these athletes who are playing the finals now, it will be a long tournament overall, and with the team events starting just after, not a lot of time to either celebrate or rest, really.
Yeah, it's only kind of part of the job done. Even if you do go through and get the gold medal, you've invariably, I mean, the athletes are involved in the team event as well. So
yeah, definitely.
Just as important, isn't it, in its own way? It's all about medals, winning medals for your country as well as for yourself and for the team, for that matter. Little delay here at the moment because we had that gold medal match in one of the other classes going on, say on table 6, which has just finished a short time ago, so still setting things up really for the introduction of the players here for what will be the class 9 gold medal match, the standing classes here on table 2. As I say, there's just a little delay here at the moment before we have the players introduced here for this one,
allowing proper time of course to the the wheelchair players who have finished playing to clear off, to calm down after such an exciting match, and also for these two women singles class 9 finalists to get a proper introduction.
Yeah, they will be introduced on your screen there from the top, well, kind of middle, top right of your screen. So they will come on, but everything is being set up for what is a key match in itself. We mentioned already the fact that we're down to the two tables here at this point. They do such a good job, actually, the organisers, with that. We've seen that while matches are going on, they're already getting rid of a table, getting it moved away. They don't make too much noise, although they try and keep the disturbances to a minimum there. But it takes a lot of moving around and everything in the arena to get everything set up, especially as you move through the event.
And the players, anyway, would be used to having other things going on in the background anyway. We had 8 competition tables here, so whenever you were playing, there would be our other matches going on. So if one table's being cleared out and the podium set up or whatever, it wouldn't necessarily be much of a disturbance to the players who played at that time. Another thing also being the focus on your match, and doesn't really necessarily mean that you even hear or notice what else is going on.
Yeah, you're so focused, so in the zone of your own match that you, anything could be going on.
At least you should be, and that's what the best players do, I believe. The less you notice the environment or any possible disturbances, the better for your game.
Yeah, some players even sometimes forget the score, don't they? They just kind of play a point so much on it. Some athletes do that, don't they? That they get so focused that they sometimes have to be reminded of the score on occasion in matches, because you're playing it point by point.
Yeah, and on occasion they keep it in their mind, but don't look to the scoreboard, and then if the umpire does a mistake, it sometimes takes 2 or 3 points for the players or the coaches to notice it and correct them.
Now, all interesting, the psychology of the sport and how you approach things as an athlete when you're out there at the table. The different approaches, different mindsets, mentality, everything else that goes into elite competition. And of course, this is the biggest stage of all the Paralympic Games. Get all manner of athletes, different backgrounds, levels, coming here to compete on the biggest stage of all. And of course, we have reached the gold medal match. Just to update you, a little bit of a delay here at the moment because of a match which finished only a short time ago on table 6. And that's just why the players are being held here for the proper introduction here on table 2 that their achievements deserve, because it is a gold medal match in the class 9 that we are building up to here. As I say, the players to be introduced very soon here. I remember, actually, I was at the test event for this, for overall the test events that were taking place at that time. They do everything immaculately, the organisers. I don't think there was any doubt at the time that they put on great events. I mean, again, looking at it, the wider Tokyo sporting summer, the Paralympics and the Olympics here, but it is a fantastic venue with the lighting and everything else.
Yeah, and there's always lots and lots of scheduling involved when it comes to table tennis tournaments, because you have 11 classes, so many players, 8 tables here, normally at tournaments even more at a time. So it has to be done really well by technical delegates and officials.
Yeah, a lot of visits, a lot of site visits and everything else to get everything set up and ready. And that's what they're doing at the moment here. Just getting things ready for this. To confirm again, Class 9 Women's Singles Gold Medal match taking place on the table in the centre of your picture. There, more or less, they will be with us very soon, the players, for this one.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, the victory ceremony for the men's singles class 2.
皆様、ただいまより男子シングルスクラス2の表彰式を行います。
Please welcome the medalists.
メダリストをお迎えください。
The medals will be presented by
メダルの贈呈は
Mr. Lionel De Rocha Pinto, Governing Board Member of the International Paralympic Committee.
Lionel De Rocha Pinto, IPC 理事
Accompanied by
続きまして
Mr. Hasebe Ken, Mayor of Shibuya City.
Hasebe Ken, 渋谷区長
Bronze medalist representing Republic of Korea and representing Republic of Korea.
銅メダリスト、大韓民国および大韓民国。
Ta Soo Young and Park Jin Tol. Silver medalist representing Poland.
銀メダリスト、ポーランド。
Rafael Chupa. Gold medalist and Paralympic champion representing France.
金メダリストおよびパラリンピックチャンピオン。
フランス、リメロ。 Ladies and gentlemen, the national anthem of France.
皆様、フランス国歌の演奏です。
Ladies and gentlemen, the Paralympic medalists.
皆様、パラリンピックメダリストです。
So our next action of the afternoon into evening session is the women's singles class 9 gold medal match, gold all the way here on this Monday, and it's our third of our four finals in the afternoon into evening session, and it's People's Republic of China against Australia.
男子シングルスクラス2の表彰式を終えた卓球会場です。この後準備が整い次第、女子シングルスクラス9の決勝戦が行われます。中華人民共和国代表対オーストラリア代表となります。
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the athlete for the women's singles class 9 gold medal match.
女子シングルスクラス9決勝戦、選手入場です。
Representing People's Republic of China,
中華人民共和国代表、
Xiang Gui。
So the stage is set here for the women's singles class 9 gold medal match. First out, fittingly, the world number one here, Xiang Guiyan of China. Top of the rankings, 45 years of age.
Australia.
Former Paralympic medalist in the Rio Paralympics in the women's team event. Xiang here is up against one of her great rivals, actually, over the years. They've played 15 times previously at the top level. It's Lei Lina of Australia, formerly of China, of course, represented China at 4 Paralympic Games in the past, but now in the green and gold of Australia here in this gold medal match.
Umpires for this third final of the evening into afternoon.
Our main umpire for this one is Choi Chang Seong of the Republic of Korea.
From Republic of Korea.
It's Lei who has won the spin of the coin here. Assistant official Igarashi Kumiko of Japan. For this class 9 encounter. Because these are the standing classes, classes so 6 through to 11. Xiang, 45 years of age, mentioned Lina silver medalist Lei. In the women's team event in Rio, fifth in Rio in the singles. Lei, five times a Paralympics gold medalist, three silver medals as well, six times a world championship gold medalist. Doesn't want for medals at home, Lei, does she?
Well, but whichever one it will be her first one for Australia, her new home. And yeah, the silver that you mentioned from Rio, she actually won together with her opponent today.
Indeed, a bit of that history as well there as well. That's before the nationality switch that occurred after the Rio Paralympics for Lei, moving from China to Australia with that intention of representing them here, which is exactly what's happened. Start here with Xiong here of China and her path through. It's been a pretty good one, hasn't it? Just the two games dropped.
Yeah, very nice, smooth running, and interesting player with this penholder style of play, which you don't see that much anymore, especially not in women's and in para table tennis competitions.
Representing People's Republic of China,
motion of the officials for this one, Choi, our main umpire for this.
Asian Para Games champion,
from the Republic of Korea.
She has retained
his home interest here. Assistant official Igarashi Kumiko of Japan to take care of the scores and any edge balls and everything else. Assistant official. Quite a meaty head-to-head between the two overall. Lei 9 and 6. I mean, you referenced the fact they've won medals together. But interesting now, as you might expect, she's 12 years younger, has actually won the last four in the head-to-head. She was 6-5 down and has won four in recent times. I guess you give her the advantage, even though Xiong is the number one player in the world?
Yeah, I think that Lei's drop in the ranking might also be a bit of a consequence of her being out of competition for a while as she switched nationalities. So in each case, it's more than fair to say that the players know each other really well. So there won't be any surprises for each other in those terms, I assume. Although, on the other hand, there were no table tennis competitions for 2 years now before the Paralympics, and since Lei moved to the down under, so to speak, they probably didn't get to face each other much during that time. So it's not like they have experience playing with or against each other in the last preparation period for this match.
Yeah, class 9 gold medal match beginning then here in the women's singles here at the Tokyo 2020 Paralympic Games. Xiong Guiyan of China, the world number one, taking on five-time Paralympic Games gold medalist Lei Linar of Australia, formerly of China. A lot of history between these two, those 15 career meetings. In fact, they've won medals together before. A few secrets out here. A good start from the Chinese woman here. First 3 points all in her favour.
So we have a left-handed player against a pen holder.
Don't see these every day of the
week,
do you?
No, no.
Just acknowledges that, just I think catching the edge on the way through. Gets her on the board. Yeah, very unusual matchup.
As far as background stories as well as what's happening on the table. Class 9, one of the upper classes in para table tennis, meaning, of course, the players are very mobile, very agile around the table, and consequently the game itself much faster.
Did well for a while there, Xiong, being right on top of the table, top of the bounce, lost the point in the end. No, it's a good point you make about that. When you get to classes 9 and 10, I mean, a lot of these players playing in playing non-disabled players as well in terms of their preparations and what they do normally. Xiong's a good example of that. It's represented it's Heilongjiang province back in China in non-disabled competition.
Yeah, and also served as a coach for her team, non-disabled club. But because it is a higher class, it's also interesting or a bit more unusual that she's using a defensive rubber, which slows down the game, kills the spin on the ball.
Yeah, get a good look at it. Brief look at it there. Let's come back into this first game. Lei here, still trailing by two though, but has the service. Oh, that's very unlucky.
Five, eight.
Brilliant. Super point from the Chinese.
That's what you would expect to see in a final, in a fight for gold.
This is cross table there, and now she can't go and tail down there. It's after every 6 points, of course, you're allowed to, wanted to. It's 4 game points here. First two of them, she needs them on lay serve here for Xiong. And just the one needed. What a start here from the world number one. Xiong wins that opening game 11-6. Talked a lot about the head-to-head between them, the fact there's few secrets, but she seemed to have a clear game plan from the off there, looking at that first game, how she's approaching the match tactically.
You would normally, let's say, always start with a game plan tailored to what your experience is with a certain player. But of course you have to adjust it if that doesn't work.
Not much adjustment needed so far. Got on top early on, and Lei coming back into that first game a little bit. Not enough. Losing it 11-6, so in the best of five. So it's been throughout the singles, of course. One down here. The Australian. Former Chinese player. Chinese player here, the world number one, on top. See what she looks to do here tactically, maybe to change things up a bit here in this second game, Lei. The game down.
Second game, Xiong to serve, Lover. Stop! One, one.
Very close to the table, isn't she, at all times? Something you noticed so far, the pen holder. Not giving up any ground.
Yeah, that's a style that needs to be adapted with this pen holder grip on the racket. Nice study of how she turns the racket around to switch between the two rubbers. Have noticed that also the sound of the bounce of the ball is different when she does it with the red pimples rubber.
Yeah, like that's so smooth, that off the smooth side there. But yeah, it's a different sort of sound, isn't it? It's a bit I always remember someone said to me, didn't actually follow the sport, they said it just sounds a bit more hollow.
Yeah.
Do you get where they're coming from with that?
Not a
technical, it's just the sound. Sounds a bit
but
more hollow.
But actually it's true for the ball as well, because there's no spin on it, and so that is kind of hollow in terms of the spin of the ball.
Stood up well there, Lei, was moved side to side.
Yeah, the way these two are playing, you'd hardly think their disabilities, any impairment at all. But you can see well here that Lei was born with a lower right leg impairment.
Yeah, the movement, as I say, the quality, so far so good.
And if this looks fast, you must realize that it is, and it feels even faster live, and especially behind the table, of course.
Lead up to three now for Lei.
Like she's managed to make those adjustments in the first break between the games. Oof, brilliant. Brilliant edging, brilliant shortening.
Aggressive table tennis again there from Lei, closing on this second game. It'll be five game points then to level this up. Again, just the one required, clinical her way that time for Lei Lina. 11-5 this time for her in this gold medal match. Now one game apiece. Good fight back there from Lei. I mean, it's similar, wasn't it? Got out into a lead, and the player who's out in front then is able to hold on to the advantage through to that 11-point decision.
Yeah, and she is the favourite despite a lower position in the ranking, I would say.
Yeah, four in the rankings at the moment, but a former world number one. As mentioned, a five-time Paralympic Games gold medalist, three other Paralympic silver medals as well for Lei Lina. Six times a world championship gold medalist. And back into this gold medal match in the class nine with Xiong Guiyan. One game apiece now here. Looking back at some of the highlights from that second game won by the Australian. Into the pen holder's backhand side.
Yeah, backhand to backhand down the line here since Lei is left-handed.
Smashes that away. Can we carry on the momentum she's built up from winning the second, Lei?
Yeah, normally we'd consider left-handedness an advantage, like in any other racket sport, since it forces the opponent to kind of switch the game, switch the system in their head of playing for 180 degrees. But since these two have played together so many times, probably practiced together as well, I don't think it's any issue at all for Xiong.
Trying to make those readjustments in a fraction of a second there, popping up off the tape. And the run continues here for Lei, taking charge of this match now.
Looks like Lei was the one who needed game one to warm back up. The players usually, of course, always warm up in the warm-up area before the match, but since they have to wait for about a half an hour or even longer in the on-call room before the match starts to be presented, especially in the finals, they would have, of course, cooled down completely. So it's no surprise that it can take them a game or a few points at least to come back.
No, great point you make there. It seems like she has definitely warmed up now.
Yeah.
Motoring along here, laying in this third. It's been losing that point, still a lead of four. Caught the edge,
but it was a great shot, so point well deserved.
A timeout called here, because you're only allowed the one per match, and they've gone with it here with the lead. Narrowing, still a lead of three. Interesting decision there for the Australian to go for the timeout in this third game. Still a lead of three.
Yeah, apparently she feels like she needs this break and she really wants to take game two, make sure she's in the lead.
Yeah, interesting, isn't it? I mean, because she really often timeouts are called by the bench. I mean, really, they kind of lead with it. They go, OK, well, this is the moment where we need to use it. But it seemed to come from her more than anything. She just thought at that moment, I guess that's all the experience as well. She's been in the situation so many times that she feels she can, okay, as you suggested, this is the moment. We need to use it here. I need to go 2-1 up.
Yeah, I myself was the type of a player who always preferred to call a timeout myself. After a couple of years, I also felt I know best when it is that I need it and when not. But it's another thing that's individual preference, or, well, not preference, but need.
See whether it works out here for Lei. Let's serve to begin here. Still a lead of three, but she's used her timeout now, trying to go on and take this 2-1 lead. No immediate reward.
Perfect. I was starting to wonder if something didn't feel right physically for Lei to take that timeout and trying to break the game and losing the next 2 points as well, but she seems to be all right.
Yeah, reasserting herself here, largely off the timeout. 2 points now from a 2-1 lead. Very well there, ball from Xiong here. He just caught the back of the table there almost and drove it effectively. Maybe didn't expect that to come back. 5 game points. Yeah, again, super, because the length from the Chinese was good. She handled it all, and she's handling the world number one right now. From a game down, Lei. Now 2-1 up in games here, taking the third. Again, 11-5. What do you often say about the timeout? You take it if you feel it can influence the outcome of the match. And you have to say there, while we were questioning it a little bit, she turned around and go, OK, but I've gone on to win the third game. I've got the reward out of it that I needed.
Yeah, but the interesting feature here, I think, is also that the Chinese coach is bound to know both the players better than Lei's coach knows her. So in this case, also would be funny to think about who benefits more from a timeout like that.
World number one needing a good start here in this fourth game, needing to win it. Xiong Guiyan, she's going to keep her gold medal hopes alive. 2-1 down in games now to Lei Lina, Australia. teasing there, that receive. I just think that, always think that sort of floated receive, it's a little bit like you're dangling the carrot there, just kind of teasing the third ball attack.
But just exhibited here by Lee that it takes a lot of precision, great timing, and there's these balls are dangerous actually to make.
Feature of this this gold medal match, the length kept by both in the main. Their rally ball.
It is one of the things you have to maintain, either really short or really long.
Yeah, you don't want to get stuck in between, because they're the balls that can be attacked off. Example of it there, maybe lay first in, didn't really get the push right. That allowed.
And then late on that last stroke, hit it with the edge of the racket.
Nothing wrong with
this
that
time.
Point. And that's quality, isn't it?
Yeah, that is textbook. This stroke, how much spin.
Responding there, she needs to do slender advantage here, approaching the, well, we are now pretty much at the midpoint of this fourth game. Another serve to come here for Xiong. Very good there from Lei as well, because I mean she's slightly pushed out of out to end of range there on the forehand. Got a very good block back onto the table.
Yeah, she seems to have this return against the pimples under control. Yeah, Xiong trying something different now because she wasn't getting anywhere with her blocks. But making that topspin shot with the pimple rubbers is even more difficult than with the smooth ones. Beautiful here. First cross table and then down the line.
Huge point here. Second of the serves for Xiong before she hands it back. And she's taken it, both those points. So important for her at 5-7 to stay strong, stand firm as she did there.
Yeah, this is where this game breaks. Great length once again. She waited for that forehand topspin. Perfect timing. No, not so much here.
So this back with the Chinese. Been a big factor though, the service in this game. She's snuck out the point there in the end, and they were both actually going into that 4-1-4 lost on their service in this game. Sneaking in front here. Xiong, it really is just sneaking in front though at 9-8.
Yeah, that's another consequence of knowing each other so well. I think the serve can't be. There can't be too much of this surprise in it.
Has got both of her points though here though, and she's put the pressure on Lei. Now two game points down.
At the right time for Xiong.
No successful receive on the first of them. Still another game point here for Lei to try and save. to stop this going into a deciding fifth game. She has
hesitated for just a split of a second, deciding whether to chop it or top spin it. Yeah. It was too much.
That's the difference at this level. A fraction of a second makes the misjudgment, and this is going the distance. This Class 9 gold medal match, Xiong hitting back to take the fourth, 11 points to 9. Two each now. How are you feeling it at this stage, what you've seen so far here? 25 minutes of play, two each. Mentioned that not many secrets there, and so it shaped out, actually, the four games we've seen so far. Difficult to call this going into the fifth.
Yeah, I would say so. One other thing perhaps to consider is that Xiong is 10 years older, and in a standing match where there's a lot of moving, a lot of action going into the fifth, physical condition might play a role. But of course, the mental condition that much more important.
Yeah, absolutely, especially at this stage. One game to decide it, the gold medal. To retake the title here, of course, Lei Li Na having come up short in Rio, having won it the two previous events, this Class 9 category, looking to get back there. Oh, just pushing. What defense, though, from Lei!
That was some amazing rallies.
And it's not just defence, in a sense. I mean, there was controlled aggression as well. Some of it in there from Lei. What a start here from the Australian, who, of course, was representing China when she won those gold medals we mentioned and the silver in Rio. Timeout not surprisingly called here for Xiong, because this fifth game has quickly gotten away from her. That timeout, of course, Lei using hers on her way to taking the third game of this gold medal match. Now Xiong here at four down already.
Yeah,
so it's the manner of it as well, how quickly it's happened.
Yeah, nothing's decided, but 4-4 love is
long way back.
Is a long way back, and she didn't really do much wrong, to be honest. It was amazing rallies. Just Lei was stronger.
Resuming with the service, of course, Lei here, 4-0 up. Extending it. Already looking like it might be too tall an order here for Xiong. At this level, you lose that number of points in a row to begin a game. It's a long way back. They switch around, of course, in the decider, 5 points in. She's got plenty to ponder here, the world number one. She possibly plots a route back into this again. Get some fortune there to get on the board.
Even little details like that can turn a match around. But Lei doesn't seem to be bothered.
Well, she's just rushing a little bit there, Xiong, there in the end of that point. Yeah, nothing wrong with that. Whoa, take that, she says.
On the line.
Super shot. Yeah. trailing by five again. Of course, lost the first 5 points of the decider. Zhang here to lay. It's just very difficult at this level. Lose that number of points being in a game to claw it back.
Yeah, Lei just keeps putting pressure on her with this topspin, and even her defense is strong.
She's got her now, you feel. Not sure there's going to be any comeback here for the world number one from this position. Lei is closing in. Of course, winner in Beijing and London, silver medal in Rio in this class. Still two away. That forehand, devastating in this decider in particular.
This should be enough. 7 gold medal points.
Plenty of opportunities.
A bit too quick on this one. Just a moment of lost concentration. She has to finish the match before she can get that medal. Gold one, that is.
And done it this time. She is the gold medalist once again here at the Paralympic Games. Lei Lina has won the gold medal in the class 9 once again. She's seen off the world number one, Xiongwei Yan. And of course, Lei, who won those gold medals for China, now seals the gold for Australia. 11-5 in the decider.
In all her winning games, actually.
Yeah, joy for Lei Lina. I mean, the way she played that decider was really, really impressive. I mean, a very high-quality final, actually, 31 minutes of it. We really enjoyed plenty of the rallies that they put together. But in that decider, just was the stronger player. Just seemed to have a little bit more about her.
Yeah, we saw great table tennis throughout this match, but especially in game five. So we can be happy that it actually... that they brought us this far.
That's a very broad smile indeed.
Yeah, it was a really good quality gold medal match. Full credit to Xiong for the part she played in, and of course coming back to force the fifth. But Lei was the stronger player in that decider. Of course, 8 Paralympic Games medals in her career, 5 gold, 3 silver. Now make that 6 golds. 3 silvers, a 9th Paralympic Games medal of her career, 6th gold. One of the standout achievers in the sport for a very long time now.
And she'll have to face her former teammates in the team event, so that should be interesting once again.
Yeah, braces the rest of her, her team, of course. Lei Lina delighted for her after that performance. The numbers overall, with it actually looks a bit more convincing for her than it maybe did in the scoreline. I mean, you look at those numbers.
Yeah, but biggest lead, 7 points, and 7 points, and that was in this decisive game five.
Ladies and gentlemen, the victory ceremony for the men's singles, class 4.
皆様、ただいまより男子シングルスクラス4の表彰式を行います。
Please welcome the medalists.
メダリストをお迎えください。
The medals will be presented by
メダルの贈呈は
Mr. Hasebe Ken, Mayor of Shibuya City.
長谷部健、渋谷区長。
Accompanied by
続きまして
Mr. Sato Hiroshi, Vice Director General of the Tokyo Organizing Committee of the Olympic and Paralympic Games.
佐藤博士、東京オリンピック・パラリンピック競技大会組織委員会副事務総長。
Bronze medalist representing France and representing Turkey.
銅メダリスト、フランスおよびトルコ。
Maxine Thomas and Nesim Duran.Silver medalist representing Republic of Korea.
銀メダリスト、大韓民国。
Kim Young Gun. Medalist and Paralympic champion representing Turkey.
金メダリストおよびパラリンピックチャンピオン、トルコ。
Abdullah Öztürk. Ladies and gentlemen, the national anthem of Turkey.
皆様、トルコ国歌の演奏です。
Ladies and gentlemen, the Paralympic medalists.
皆様、パラリンピックメダリストです。
I think he can hear you. So we are two victory ceremonies down, two victory ceremonies to go, and one match action to go. That match action comes up very shortly indeed. It's the women's singles class 10 gold medal match, and then both victory ceremonies will then follow.
Yes, 素晴らしいトルコのチームスタッフの祝福がありました。さあこの後なんですけれども今日のラストマッチになります女子シングルスクラス10決勝戦オーストラリア代表対ブラジル代表が控えていますその後女子シングルスクラス9クラス10の表彰式を執り行います
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the athletes for the women's singles class 10 gold medal match.
女子シングルスクラス10決勝戦選手入場です。
Representing Australia,
オーストラリア代表
Chi Yang.
So.The Class 10 gold medal match in the women's singles. First out here, the giant killer of this draw, Yang Qian of Australia. It's beaten Natalia Partica, the four-time gold medalist, and also Australian Melissa Tapper along the way the last couple of rounds to reach this gold medal match in the Class 10 Yang. And she's up against Brazil's Bruna Costa Alexandra.
Yeah, this is probably the most unexpected final match of the entire para table tennis tournament this year.
Yeah, because, I mean, on the face of it, you've got three in the world, Yang playing four in the rankings, Costa here. So you go, okay, gold medal match, they're not unknowns. But as you say, particularly with who Yang has beaten, slightly surprising when we would have gone in. You wouldn't, few people would have said Natalia Partica wouldn't be in the gold medal match. I mean, won the last foureditions of this, but no, they both deserve to be here, of course. Costa has won a gold medal in the World Championships in the team event in the past. Yang, for her part, a gold as well on the women's team event at London 2012. Silver the last couple of times. Mentioned Partica, because it's the pole who stopped her both times.
Definitely, but also Yang represented China in those previous Paralympic Games. So she's in a different role here, but again, not the Australian everyone was expecting to see in this final. Melissa Tapper and Natalia Partica, the two exceptional athletes who participate in both the Olympic and Paralympic Games this year.
Yeah, definitely. That was the expected final, but these two thoroughly deserve to be here. Start with Yang. We've referenced this run already. Of course, what she did in responding from a loss, actually, of course, in the group stage. I mean, it's been a very unlikely run, and you look at the knockout stages, the wins over Tapper and then Partica, what was it, 12-10 in the fifth that she managed to get by her. And then Costa's run through here. Very impressive, actually, how she's made her way through to this gold medal match.
Yeah, but it's actually because of her loss in the group stage that Yang had to face such difficult opponents in the knockouts.
Yeah, had to play that extra match, basically, as a result, not winning her group. In terms of the officials here, for this one, just being introduced, Ingrid Berggren of Sweden and Lyudmila Ryazhnova of Russia there, who are in the positions for this. Class 10, of course, so those of you not aware, the standing classes, we have classes 6 to 10, and then the class for intellectual impairments, class 11. I mean, when you're through at 10 here, you've referenced it a little bit already, talking about Partica and Tapper playing in the Olympics. I mean, this is quality at this level. I mean, there's not a lot really different. You get a lot of players who are playing that as well. Really high quality rallies you can get here.
Yeah, in terms of disability or mobility, movement around the table, this is as close to non-disabled table tennis as you can go. And Costa Alexandra herself represented Brazil in the 2017 Pan-American Championships and won bronze with her team.
Yeah, good start from her here, from the Brazilian, as you say. Oh, the response there, so quick into position. I mean, it's just razor sharp from Yang.
And also, the only thing these two players have missing, in quotes, in terms of their impairment, is the non-playing arm. So when it comes to leg work, there's no difference to non-disabled players.
Yeah, terrific athletes, both of them. We're already seeing that in these first few points. Just the movement as well, split steps, everything else. Footwork is superb here from the off.
I'm curious, since Costa Alexandra is left-handed, but her disability is a consequence of arm amputation after a thrombosis at 6 years old. And yeah, I'm wondering whether she was actually right-handed before that happened. Because we do have some players here who had to switch their handedness, basically, after their disabilities hit.
Another just change of direction, one after another there from Yang.
Now you'll probably ask why are they categorized as disabled at all if all they're missing is their non-playing arm, but of course that does play a big role in table tennis anyway. Even if they're not playing with it, it provides balance of the body.
Good start here from Costa. Doesn't have the, talked about it yet, doesn't have the best head-to-head with Yang at all the previous matches they've played. But oh, a little strawberry receive from Costa there as well. It's largely all coming off here. What a start.
Yeah, but the last time the two of them faced each other was 5 years ago at the Paralympic Games in Rio, so that's not too much of a reference anymore.
Yeah, a lot, of course, can change since then, particularly, as you say, with Costa's development. Yeah, the head-to-head 7-1 for Yang overall, including that win in the group stages in Rio.
Yeah, game breakdown even more in Yang's favor, 22-9.
Super shot there from Yang, backhand side, just on top of the bounce. Trying to stay interested in this first game, the Australian. Plays with a lot of variety, actually, Costa, with the strawberry and the banana receives. Oh, and then thumping strike, thumping finish there to that point from the Brazilian.
Two down the lines in a row. One to forehand, one to backhand. Very nice. I wasn't in great position for this one. She knows it. Fiery player, always encouraging herself, pumping herself up.
Yeah, really pumped up and has three game points here, Costa. Receive, aggressive receive, just watch that so well, Yang, to be able to drive it in the receive.
And timeout already.
More of a traditional sort of timeout call here, historically, since timeouts came into play in the sport here from the Brazilian bench, from the coach here at 10-9 with a serve to come. This is a bit more traditional
from what we see. Yeah, she wants this first game, and as she is to serve, of course, that's something that she can now decide on which tactics, which serve to take to try win that one point.
Yeah, what is the timeout about? It's about influencing the outcome of the match or a game, and that's exactly, so this is the traditional way. Okay, lost the first game point, still got the service, can spend that minute thinking about, okay, how do I set up this next point to take it?
Yeah, exactly.
See whether it works out for her here or whether Yang can repel the Brazilian for a second time. Oh, it's just brilliant. Yeah, the reaction to match. The Australian putting everything into that point and saves the second game point here. But such resilience, hasn't she, Yang? Seen this through the draw. Even in positions there. Two game points down, doesn't get down on herself. Really good attitude. Game point now for her. She's denied though.
Two-point margin, of course, needed to win this game in tiebreak.
Yeah, service rotating, of course, and a bit of moisture getting onto the table there. Quickly wiped down. Sweaty work under the lights. Great stuff, cross table from Yang.
Almost there.
Second game point. And that's the one.
There she is.
Coming from 8-10 there, two game points saved along the way. And it is Yang Qian who takes the opening game of this one, 13-11.
Quite literally finished this set on the wrong foot. Costa Alexandra and figuratively speaking as well.
Yeah, both having, well, she had the chances first at 10-8. They actually played a really, we were complimenting her, played a really good game to get into that position. But Yang's shown this. I mean, if you look at the big wins, the headline wins, if you like, to get to this match, the wins over Tapper and then over Partika, particularly the four-time defending champion who she upset in the semi-final. It's that sort of resilience as well as the quality. Saving game points. You've got to have that as well, that quality to win gold medals.
Most definitely. On the other hand, she did also have many more difficult matches than Costa Alexandra, so we'll see. She'd probably like to finish this one fast.
Game beginning here with Bruna Costa Alexandra of Brazil, who had game points in the opener, finding herself a game down here to Yang Qian of Australia. Making a quick start here to game number two, the first three against the Aussie. Super start here. I mean, this is similar to how she started the match.
Yeah, but she failed to finish it in the first one.
Whips that one away. This is so good, isn't it? What we've seen here, this first game and a half between these two. That's just top draw. Finishing play from Yang. Oh. They're so quick to see an opportunity.
Yeah, and taking every one of them.
There's that variety again coming around the outside of the ball there, scooping. Talk a lot, don't we, about strawberries and banana receives. Both have got considerable variety in their game styles as well they're bringing to this match.
It's funny how the timeout did nothing for Costa Alexandra in the first game, but apparently the break between the two games did. Brilliant, brilliant placement. Even with two healthy legs. Yang was too slow.
Oh!
Ooh.
I mean, again, delighting everyone, I'm sure, watching this around the world. Not just those, of course, gathered from the respective, well, the athletes, of course, by this stage, watching on, creating some atmosphere here in the arena. So many good rallies already. Will shortly be one game apiece, although Yang, of course, did come from behind in the first game.
A lot of net balls now for Costa Alexandra. Could be the wrong timing or not enough spin in the stroke.
And he make sure that surface is bone dry at all times.
Yeah, I don't want it to be slippery because the bounce would be off then.
Two game points in the opener she couldn't take. Five more here for Costa Alexandra.
Hopefully she won't be too much in her head with this scenario repeating itself.
Not
doesn't have to be.
Indeed. The second game points the one, and Bruna Costa Alexandra of Brazil here back level with Yang Qian of Australia. One game apiece in this gold medal match in the class 10. The second game is hers, 11-6. So back level here, one apiece, Bruna Costa Alexandra with Yang Qian. It's the gold medal match in the class 10 here in the women's singles here at these Tokyo 2020 Paralympic Games. And it's not disappointed so far. The first couple of games we've seen from both of these two, really good stuff.
Not at all. Lovely rallies. Lovely variation in the game on both sides.
That's a good word, actually. Variation is a good way of putting it with both of them, actually. The skill set that they have, the variety, just contributes to the spectacle, to the matchup. And Costa Alexandra, when she's in full flow like that, very tough to stop.
It looks like it's very, very hot in the arena. Air conditioning has to be limited at table tennis matches, of course. Wouldn't want wind blowing around the table.
No, because then you can get the issue actually they have in badminton, for example, where you can get drift from one end to another, and you wouldn't want that. You wouldn't want the ball drifting around too much. I mean, there's already enough work on that ball as it is. These athletes put on it with the spin and everything else. Oh, quick start again from the Brazilian here to a game. Four of the first five. The other thing as well is just all athletes, I mean, sweat different levels as well. Some athletes sweat more under the lights than others do.
Yeah, and under the spotlights as well. It's really interesting how many times Costa Alexandra hits that net.
Yeah, a lot of the times not playing with, as you say, not with a lot of net clearance. Oh, come on! Oh. Oh. Stunning!
Absolutely amazing, and what placement by Yang. Costa Alexandra returns in kind.
Point for point at the moment. After the fast start, though, that she made, remember she was 4-1 up. This has been a good recovery from Yang into this third game. Always controlling that exchange from the fast serve. Deep and wide, Yang able to get a good third ball in behind it as well.
Yeah, but she's caught Costa Alexandra off guard in the middle a couple of times now. Now she can't do it every time, because this time she was ready. The Brazilian.
Again, the surface needing to be dried. Yeah, did really well there, wide at the table. Yang there, around the outside of the ball. A lot of work on it, on the forehand. In the lead now in this third game. Extending it there. It's trailed, of course, really throughout the third game to this moment. A lead of two. all about raising your level at the key times, isn't it?
Yep.
Yeah, big service coming up here for the Brazilian, taking the first of these points. Oh, and finally finds the net with the service. That hands Yang the advantage. Serves to come here to try and retake the lead in the gold medal match.
How fast is that?
Another one. Just getting treated here, aren't we? Quick fire stuff that time in favour of the Australian, who's got three game points here. And just needs the one. Clinical there. Yang Chen back in front in the gold medal match in the class 10. Takes the third here off Costa Alexandra. 11 points to 7. 2-1 she leads now. Game number 4 beginning here. Bruna Costa Alexandra back behind again in this Class 10 gold medal match. An excellent start, forehand side. We've said that a few times about her, about both of them. Yang Chen here of Australia, game away from the gold medal. Won't be getting ahead of herself, of course, but it's been the goal that's been elusive for her in her career at the Paralympic Games. Different opponent, though, here in the gold medal match to the one she faced previously and indeed got the better of here in Tokyo.
Yeah, she's also beat. She's already beaten the one that she would be expected to face in the finals.
It's fishing from under the table there, Costa Alexandra. Good blocking as well, keeping good position, eventually losing out. Just maybe snatches at that a touch. Yeah, some observers have kind of said with Yang after who she's beaten, kind of deserves the gold medal. Doesn't work like that, though.
No.
And she's maybe starting to close in now. Still quite a bit to do. But great platform here for the Australian, no question.
Critical time for Costa Alexandra, but she's already used up her timeout.
Yeah, used that timeout, of course, to try and close the opening game, which she wasn't able to do. Took it at 10-9 and ended up losing that game 13-11. And it's running away from her now. This is a little bit out of keeping with how the previous three games have been played. I mean, she did go out to a 4-1 lead in the previous game, but this seems more decisive.
Well, it's like her concentration let down, or she just doesn't have an idea of what else she could try. It's up to Yang now really to just keep it up for four more points at least.
Well, after the disappointments in London and Rio, albeit against a different opponent, she won't be getting ahead of herself here. Still four more points required. Wiping her table, actually just giving her a moment as well there, perhaps to steady herself again. And she misses out with that one, and the gap here starting to narrow a touch. Another service to come here. Desperately wants this. Just to keep Costa Alexandra away from her.
No.
Six won the lead and 7-2, now back to 7-5.
Should make good use at least of this towel break now.
Wow. She's well and truly back in this now. Maybe she looked... Some people wondering if she was spent really at 7-2 down here, Costa Alexandra, but she's come back here brilliantly into this decider. And not surprisingly here, the timeout now is used.
Yeah, a bit late even, I would say.
I was about to say, actually, maybe it could have come a couple of points previously, you felt. They were just delaying unnecessarily there to call it. Wondered actually whether before the services, actually when she was 7-4, whether that was the time to come in and bring it into play. Of course, it's all academic now, but now back just 1 point down, and of course the Brazilian to come with the service. Just wonder whether that was a bit of a tactical misjudgment part of the Australians, having kept the time out back, which was absolutely spot on, to then delay it a little bit further. We'll see. She's well and truly back in this now, in the decider, Costa Alexandra. 7-2 trailed. Now just 1 point adrift, and of course, service to come.
A revenge for game one, perhaps. The psychological advantage definitely on the Brazilian side now. Because Yang had the match in her hands.
Yeah, led by five. And this decider, of course, is led. She'll hope it'll be the deciding fourth game. That's massive for her, isn't it, after what's gone on before? Just got to be, you often say about it, that point-by-point philosophy here. Just break it down. But it's all a bit more tense, a bit more tight now on the part of Yang compared to how she started this game. Locked level now.
Two down, two more to go, perhaps. Finally.
Still two away. Now she will not be, I think, from Yang's point of view. We dwell on her a lot because, of course, she's lost the silver medal, got the silver medal, lost the gold medal matches in the two previous Paralympic Games. She's been very close in that sense and is still very close here. Got to give the Brazilian here tons of credit for the comeback in this game.
Yeah, Yang must feel pressured, like after the era of Natalia Partica, and she beat her here. She must feel this is her perhaps once in a lifetime chance to get that gold.
Still only 25 years of age, of course, but as you say, I mean, it's a golden opportunity, literally, that's opened up, and she's very close now. Deep breaths, gold medal point for the Australian.
And
she's done it!
She's taken it!
Finally, she can celebrate the Paralympic Games gold medal in the Class 10. Yang Qian of Australia is the champion. She's really had to dig deep there in the end to see off Bruna Costa Alexandra, the Brazilian, in four games. But after disappointment, of course, in the gold medal match in London and in Rio, here in Tokyo, it's a different story. Yang wins the gold medal this time.
Representing Australia, Qi Yang.
How sweet is that going to taste for after everything that's gone on before in her career, those near misses
in
the gold medal match?
Yeah, no doubt, a huge burden off her chest as well.
Became very tense at the end there. First match point.
I think that will also make it even sweeter for her in the end. And when you waited for your chance and for your gold for such a long time.
Yeah, it's finally hers. Of course, beat Partika in the semi-finals, the four times defending champion, and now has gone on to consolidate that. High fives with the rest of the Australian support. Be delighted for her after those near misses to finally come through. Third time lucky, in a sense.
Yeah.
Word for her opponent, though, here. You know, the event that Bruna Costa Alexandra's had. I mean, she'd be very, very disappointed, but she often said, I mean, the silver medal, the tournament that she's had as well, that's a huge result for her and for a nation as well in terms of building the sport.
No doubt, no doubt.
And that is the women's singles class nine.
Yeah, won her first goal for Australia. Couldn't do it for China. So I'm sure her new home will be even happier to have her after this.
Yeah. Joy for Yang Qian then. The numbers overall from this one. That lead, of course, she had in what turned out to be the last game is a five-point lead. It got wiped out, but managed to get over the line there. And edging things, the numbers actually fairly tight between the two overall. It was a tight, high-quality match, but it's Yang Qian who is the winner of the gold medal in the women's singles class 10. 3-1 here over Bruna Costa Alexandra of Brazil. There we are then, Yang Qian of Australia, coming up short, of course, representing China in London and in Rio. But for Australia this time, she's gone the way through to the gold medal in the class 10 here in the women's singles. Victory over Bruna Costa Alexandra of Brazil, 3-1. Costa Alexandra, of course, the winner of the bronze medal in Rio, one up from that, but coming up short in what was a very watchable gold medal match here at these Tokyo 2020. Paralympics, really good. Watch that one. We hope you've enjoyed here at the Tokyo Metropolitan Gymnasium.